For this episode, we are going to be freeze drying shrimp. And shrimp is a really good thing to freeze dry because it comes back so easy. So I went out and bought some shrimp, and this particular shrimp has been deveined. And what that basically means is the sand vein that runs along the back of the shrimp has been removed. Some people call it the black vein, some people call it the sand vein. But what it really is the intestinal tract of the shrimp, and it's how the shrimp basically gets rid of its waste and the sand that it sometimes ingests. But anyway, I mean, you can leave the sand vein in. It's not real appealing, especially if there's some grit in there. So a lot of the shrimp that you will buy, it'll be deveined for you. And it doesn't cost much more to get deveined shrimp. If you did get a shrimp that isn't deveined, well, then all you have to do, I just get a little tip of a steak knife, and you can just cut a line right down the back of the shrimp, and then with the steak knife, you can just kind of flick the vein out, and it's pretty simple to do. Now, one thing that this shrimp actually, not only is this shrimp deveined, it's also de-shelled, if I can use that. So the shell is already missing off this shrimp. Now, but one thing that they don't do, and it depends on how you feel about your shrimp. There's a second vein, and it's the vein on the inside of the shrimp. And this vein is basically, it's a blood vein. And what this vein actually was, the purpose of this, it took blood from the head down through the different organs of the shrimp. Well, some people may not even know about this vein. I particularly don't like it because of presentation. Now, so the blood vein or the front vein can be removed the same way as the back vein. Okay, so I'm going to take my knife. I'm just going to kind of slice it right down on top of the vein here. And as you slice it, it almost takes it out automatically, kind of drags it out a little bit. And then you can get this or your fingers and just lift it out. And there you go. That's the sand vein. It's not the sand vein. It's basically the blood vessel. People come up with all sorts of names for it. But you can just kind of scrape that out and just dip it in the water, and the vein is removed. So the back vein, the sand vein, is gone. The front vein is gone. And it just looks a little bit better. And if you find yourself a good TV show, you can just pass the time watching TV as you do this, because it almost becomes subconscious to remove that vein. So I'm just going to go through all these. Now, this shrimp that I'm having tonight, this was in like I got it for a 4-pound bag. I'm going to be freeze drying half of this, just raw, and the other half I'm going to be making deep fried shrimp. So I got a movie all ready for me to watch as I do this. It's Doctor Strange. I've seen it a lot of times before. It's one of those movies that I can end up kind of half hearing, half watching at the same time. But anyway, I'm going to go through this. This is about 2 pounds of shrimp I have in here. And once it's all taken care of, I'll make the other decision whether I just want to freeze dry the shrimp as it is, or if I want to make something else. Now, my favorite shrimp dish is scampi. And that's something to do with freeze drying, except scampi has a lot of butter in it, and butter with its fat sometimes does not freeze dry well. And so there's other shrimp dishes that we can make that do freeze dry well. And I'll just have to, I guess while I'm doing the shrimp, I can figure out what I want to do with it. So anyway, I'm going to go through all this, and I'll meet you on the other side. So all the shrimp has been deveined. And I think the reason I like to use a steak knife is the steak knife has these serrated edge all the way from the tip to the back. And the serrations, I think, can grab onto the vein a lot easier. So as you're just kind of going down the shrimp, it kind of grabs onto it and makes it a lot easier to do. But anyway, this is my bowl of water, and I'm not trying to gross you out, but those are all the little veins. This is the front vein. This is the blood vein that takes the nutrients through the body of the shrimp. So this is all ready to go. And I think I'm just going to make deep fried shrimp, and that will still freeze dry rather well. Reconstituting it is a little bit tricky because it has a breaded, it's breaded. And so I'm going to split half of this. Half of this will be tonight's dinner. The other half is going to be freeze dried. Before we start cooking, I came across some other shrimp. This shrimp, I guess you could say, is jumbo shrimp. This shrimp is rated at 20 to 25, and this shrimp, the shrimp we did earlier, is more like 30. And what that is, the difference between a 20 or 30 is it takes 20 shrimp to make a pound here. With a smaller size, it takes 30 shrimp to make a pound. So the smaller the number, the bigger the shrimp. If you had a shrimp that was a number 10, they would just be gigantic shrimp. Well, these shrimp right here, still, well, they've been deveined. Almost any shrimp you buy nowadays is going to be deveined, but it still has a shell on. So you can see the shell, you can see the tail, you can see the little teeny legs. And this will still have the front blood vein in this shrimp. Well, the easiest way to take the shell off these shrimp is basically just kind of push the shell back, so you're kind of holding it around the midsection, and then just grab right above the fin here and pinch. And what you'll do, you'll actually pinch the meat out of the shrimp so you can get all the meat down here on the tail. A lot of times if you just pull that out, this will actually will break off on the bottom and you lose a little bit of your meat. But as you can see, this still has the vein on the front. So we're going to grab the steak knife. Like I said, you hold it between your pinch, almost like you're pinching the shrimp, and you just kind of take the steak knife, run it down the front. And like I said, the serrated edge does most of the work. And then either you can just pinch it out with there, or you can scrape it sideways, and the vein comes right out just like that. So I'm going to go through this shrimp. I'm going to peel it off and devein it, and we're going to add this shrimp and this shrimp together for freeze drying. I'm going to make two different batters for my shrimp. One is going to be a traditional breadcrumb batter, and the other is going to be a smooth batter. The smooth batter is a batter you'd see like in sweet and sour pork, sweet and sour chicken. It's a smooth texture that's on the meat. So this is the recipe for the smooth batter. We're going to take one egg and then 3 tablespoons of cornstarch. And then 1 teaspoon of salt, 1/4 teaspoon white powder, 1/4 cup of flour. Now you can use wheat flour because we're having this for dinner. This is actually gluten-free flour. It's the stuff that Walmart has, really good stuff. Can't tell the difference. So 1/4 cup flour, and then 1/4 cup water. Then 2 tablespoons oil. And then 1/4 teaspoon baking soda. And we're going to mix all this up. So this is where we just basically plunge the shrimp or the meat, whatever you're going to be doing, into the batter, kind of shake it off, and then drop it into hot oil. I have my shrimp with the smooth batter. Now this batter is basically what I want to call full strength. It's thick, but it can also be thinned down. But what we're going to do, we're going to take this one shrimp and we're going to coat this at full strength, and we're going to get to fry this up, and we'll see if we want to keep it full strength or if we want to thin it down. Now, one of the reasons maybe to keep the batter at full strength, so there's a lot of batter on there, is if you're going to be putting like a sauce with the shrimp, a sweet and sour sauce or another sauce, the more batter you have on your shrimp, the more sauce that can be soaked up. So that's one of the reasons maybe to have a heavy batter on the shrimp. If you want a thin batter to where you just want to eat the shrimp by itself or dip it into a sauce, well, maybe you want something thin. So this is my shrimp with full batter. Now, what we're going to do, we're going to take about an eighth of a cup and thin this down. Now, this can be either fresh shrimp or it can be freeze-dried shrimp. Either way, you can use this to make the same meal, whether it's fresh or freeze-dried shrimp. Now with this, it's quite a bit lighter, and you'll see that. So we're going to go through and do a bunch of these. And the cooking time on this is about 2 to 3 minutes until they're golden brown. If I haven't said it already, I'm cooking the shrimp at 350 degrees. So this is like a thin battered shrimp. This is a thick battered shrimp. Now you may be saying, whoa, you're putting all this oil on your shrimp that you're going to freeze dry. Won't the oil affect the life? Yes, the oil will affect the life of anything that is freeze-dried. But what we're going to do, we're going to dampen off a lot of this oil on some paper towels. And I can either freeze-dry the shrimp as it is, or if I throw some rice in there, if I make some stir-fry or some fried rice and mix it all together, the rice will absorb some of the oil. And so that way, the oil is not concentrated in just one ingredient. It's kind of concentrated and diluted throughout the entire dish, if that makes sense. All my shrimp has been fried. So I'm going to move this onto the paper towel to start removing as much oil as I can. And then I'll make some fried rice and season that, and I'll add the shrimp to it and freeze dry it, and we'll have a complete meal ready to eat sometime in the future. So I'll lay a paper towel on top of this and lightly pat it down and remove as much oils as I can. Think for a moment, if you've ever freeze dried a turkey or a chicken, how much oil is still on that meat? But yet when you get done, it's fairly dry. This is kind of like along the same concept. Okay, we're gonna put this aside and we'll make some rice and we'll go on to the other type of shrimp. For the fried rice, I got 2 cups of rice. I probably could have made 4. The vegetables, carrots and peas, and some fried egg, and some soy sauce. So we're going to put this in a pan, put our shrimp on top, and pre-freeze it and throw it in the freeze dryer. I have my shrimp that's been reconstituted, so it's all ready to go. And we're going to make breaded deep fried shrimp. And I have my stations here. So I have station number 1 is flour with 1 teaspoon of salt, 1/2 teaspoon pepper, 1/2 teaspoon paprika, 1/4 teaspoon garlic. And then I have 1 egg and 1/2 cup of milk. And I have some breadcrumbs. This is about 2 1/2 cups. And with it, I put in 1 teaspoon salt, 1/2 teaspoon pepper, 1/2 teaspoon paprika, and 1/4 teaspoon garlic. Now, if this seems familiar, you're correct. This is the same process, the same stations to make Wiener Schnitzel. The Wiener Schnitzel breading is so good, I use it on several different foods. So we're going to go ahead and take some shrimp. Take a handful of shrimp here, and we're going to put it into the flour. Now, this is going to be my wet hand. This is going to be my dry hand. So we're going to put that in. With the dry hand, we're just going to roll this around and get the shrimp floured. Then we're going to put this in the egg wash with my dry hand. And my oil is at 350 degrees. And the cooking time on this is about 2 minutes. It cooks pretty quick. Okay, with my wet hand, I'm going to go ahead and dredge this all. Okay, with my dry hand, I'm going to make like a little, little indentation. Okay, then with my wet hand, I'm going to put the shrimp and the breadcrumbs here. Maybe about 7 or so at a time. With my dry hand, I'm going to kind of cover them up. And once they're covered up, I'm just going to kind of mix them around and get them nice and coated. Pat them down. And if you're just wondering, yes, the flour is gluten-free. The breadcrumbs are gluten-free, but you could do this with wheat flour and regular breadcrumbs. You will never know the difference. Okay, so we're going to take the remaining of this. We're going to make our little dish here. Put in the shrimp with the wet hand. Cover them up with the dry hand. So I think you kind of get the idea. Okay, I'm going to wash my hands real quick. So now I'm going to go ahead and drop the shrimp in the oil. Like I said, 350 degrees for about 2 minutes. So this is my breaded shrimp, and we're going to go ahead and make the cocktail sauce for it. And this is going to be for dinner, and along with, I'll have to come up with a starch and some vegetables. But anyway, this is just one of the things you can do with shrimp, freeze-dried shrimp. Shrimp is a wonderful thing to have in your inventory. The next batch I'm going to freeze-dry is a little bit different. It's fish. Now this right here is tilapia. We got this on sale from Kroger's. They were fillets that are individually wrapped, and this is still partially frozen. The only issue with fish like tilapia here is that when it's totally thawed out, this can be kind of brittle. It can fall apart, and so you kind of have to treat it with kid's gloves. And I have, let's see, I have 10 fillets on this tray. And so I'm going to throw this into the freezer. It's partially frozen. I'm going to freeze it solid to put it in the freeze dryer. But let's see, I got tilapia. I got some salmon. So we're going to be doing a bunch of fish Most of this is going to go into my storage. We're going to pull some fillets out and prepare some of my favorite dishes. But fish is something to think about for your food storage. So on we go. Here's my tilapia straight out of the freeze dryer. It came out really good, but like I said in the past, fish fillets are generally on the thinner side, and so is this tilapia. So although these fillets look really nice right now, one of the problems with those is these fillets are usually too big to go into a jar, so that's a problem. They're big enough to go into a bag, but a bag doesn't protect them from being broken up. So although I have these really nice fish fillets now, I just fear that down the road when I need to use them, they'll be broken up. And, you know, if they're broken up, I mean, you can still eat them, but it's always nice to have an entire fish fillet that you can reconstitute and go ahead and eat. And we'll be doing that, and we'll see how it comes back. Here's one of my tilapia fillets. This is pretty standard. So we're going to go ahead and put this into a bag. And we're going to add some water to it. Hot water out of the tap. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to sit this on the counter for no more than 2 hours. And if it still isn't rehydrated by then, it goes in the refrigerator. 2 hours is your safe limit. But I'm pretty sure this will rehydrate fairly quickly. This is our freeze-dried fillet. It was in the fridge for about 2 hours. And I've taken it out of the Ziploc bag and I patted it dry. You don't want to have a wet fish fillet. You want to have this as dry as possible. So we're going to make the coating for this. And we're going to start with 3 tablespoons olive oil, 2 teaspoons of smoked paprika, 1 teaspoon garlic, 1/2 teaspoon salt, and 1/2 teaspoon pepper. And we're just going to mix this up. Now this will do 4 fillets, but for right now, I'm only doing 1 fillet. Just like that. We're going to cook this on medium-high heat in a lightly oiled pan. We're going to take our tilapia fillet and lightly baste it with our seasonings. Freeze-dried fish fillets are extremely delicate because they've gone through a freezing process and then a drying process, so you really have to be careful with these so we don't break them. But we're going to put this in the pan, season side down, for 2 minutes on each side. And while we're waiting for the cook on one side, we're going to go ahead and brush the seasoning on the opposite side. The smoked paprika is what really makes this fish wonderful. And carefully, we're going to flip this over. And we're going to go ahead and take this off the pan and onto the plate. And now the final test. Tilapia is a very mild fish, and this tastes wonderful. It's like I said, the smoked paprika is what really makes this a wonderful dish. And as far as freeze-dried food goes, it's flaky, but not dry. So, why don't you give this a try? You could probably use this with any fish, not necessarily tilapia, but it is a wonderful seasoning. The next seafood we're going to take a look at
is going to be some salmon. And salmon is a little bit more unique than the other fish I've done, because the salmon actually comes with skin, where the tilapia does not. So you can see with the salmon fillet, it actually has a skin, and underneath the skin is going to be some fat. So we're going to go ahead and process this. Now, this has been pre-frozen, and so we're going to process this in the freeze dryer and see how it comes out. Then we're going to rehydrate it, and then we'll go ahead and cook it up and see what happens with the skin when it comes time for freeze drying. So this is my freeze dried salmon fillet, and I freeze dried it with the skin down because that was only really flat section. This is not a real thick fillet, as you can see. And once it's freeze dried, I also found out it's two fillets. So we're going to go ahead and separate this into two pieces. It's the skin. So I'm going to go ahead now. This is freeze dried, so I could package this if I wanted to, but I'm going to go ahead now and reconstitute this, and then I'm going to prepare it a la Gordon Ramsay. So he has this big thing about salmon fillets and cooking these skin side down for the majority of the time to get the skin really crispy. Well, I've never done it his way, so that's what I'm hoping to do. So I'm going to go ahead and put these into a bag and with some water, and we're going to go ahead and rehydrate these. Right now it's about almost 6 o'clock in the evening, so I'm going to put these in the refrigerator to rehydrate overnight. So I have a bag of water, and it's probably about a cup and a half of water in there, and we're going to go ahead and put our fillets in here. Now I haven't cooked salmon enough to know if I should put anything in with my water, like a marinade, but since I'm going to be doing it Gordon Ramsay style, it's just going to be straight water without any seasoning. So I'm going to orient these so they're flat, and so this is going to go in the fridge overnight, and we'll see how it comes out tomorrow. This is my freeze-dried salmon. Feels like salmon, looks like salmon. Let's hope it tastes like salmon. So this rehydrated overnight is nice and soft, and the texture is just like salmon. So we're going to be putting that into the fry pan here. This is just barely starting to smoke. And we also have some three cheese risotto right here and some mixed vegetables. I figure with the size of these fillets, my guess is it's probably going to be about a 4 minute cook. They're not real thick. So we're going to cook them skin side down for about 90% of that time. And then we're going to flip them over and do the other side. And one thing we want to do, we don't want to fiddle too much with the meat. Just leave them be and let them do their thing here. Now I have this on medium-high heat with olive oil in the pan. It's been 3 minutes, so we're going to go ahead and flip those over. And we're going to go ahead and add some butter here. And I'm just going to check the cook on the other side here.
That's a nice color there. And nice color there. So I'm going to take this off the heat and let them rest just for a moment. Not bad for freeze-dried salmon, but we'll have to see what the taste is like. Then we have our salmon. So we have our three cheese risotto, mixed vegetables, salmon, a little bit of lemon juice. So now comes the big taste. Well, it's nice and flaky. It is really good. Let me get a bitter. So, skin is crunchy. Very good. So I think this freeze-dried salmon is a good thing to do, along with any other seafood you might have. So I think this has been very successful. The last two items on my freeze-drying seafood video are quite well known. We have imitation crab meat, and we have the all-time favorite tuna fish. They are seafoods also. Now, the imitation crab meat, we use a lot of that. My wife, being from Baltimore, grew up with going out on the Chesapeake Bay, and I've gone with her several times to go crabbing. Great activity. And we'll come back with blue crabs. And blue crabs, depending on the regulations, can be so big. You can only take crabs that are so wide. But blue crab meat, and I don't care whatever anyone else says, and I will argue the point, but blue crab meat is probably the best and the sweetest meat that you can find. You know, you got king crab and other types of crab. Well, they're okay, but they just don't compare with blue crab. And one of my favorite dishes of all time is a dish called imperial crab that's made out of blue crab meat. Love it. I mean, it's the best I've ever had. Plus, we also have crab cakes. Well, we're miles away from the Chesapeake Bay, and trying to get blue crab meat is hard to get, and it's very expensive. So we have to go with the artificial stuff. And this is made out of pollock and whitefish. And it actually says, according to the ingredients, up to 2% snow crab meat. So we're not going to do these two meats right now, because I've done these 3 years ago. So I went down into my storage and I got crab meat and I got tuna fish. And according to what I wrote 3 years ago, this little bag right here contains 10 cans of tuna fish. That's a lot of tuna fish in this little packet. So what we're going to do, before we open these up, we're going to test what's inside this bag with an atmosphere tester. It's this little device right here. One of the things that this thing will test is a marker that is known for testing spoiled food, and that's hydrogen sulfide. Hydrogen sulfide is like the same thing, or is one of the components of sewer gas. It's a really nasty smelling gas, but it's what is produced when food start to go bad. Now, when I did my tuna fish here, usually when you buy tuna fish, you can buy it two ways. I always buy the tuna fish that's packed in water, but you can also buy tuna fish that's packed in oil. If you're going to freeze dry tuna fish, I would not get the tuna fish is packed in oil, because that's just going to add one more ingredient that's going to make things hard to freeze dry, and that's going to be the oil that this is packed in. So all this tuna fish, the 10 cans of tuna fish in this container, was all packed in water, which makes it easier to freeze dry. So with that being said, what I'm going to do, I'm going to open up just one corner of this bag with a razor blade knife, and I'm going to insert this little probe in there that will suck out some air, and it'll suck out enough air to test, but eventually, as this sucks out the air, clean air is going to be sucked into the bag, and eventually it's going to mix. So we're going to reconstitute this food. We're going to do a taste test. I'm going to make myself my sandwich for lunch with the tuna fish, and we'll see how well this has lasted for the last 3 years. If this hasn't spoiled in the last 3 years, I'm sure it's not going to spoil in the next 17. So if this tests good, this is just one more confidence marker that freeze drying is a really good way of preserving food for the long run. We're going to do the tuna fish first, and we'll do the crab meat later. When I detect the different gases, this alarm will go off, and what we're going to expect, we're going to have a very low oxygen alarm going off because there's not going to be any oxygen in here. And then we're also going to have a carbon monoxide alarm go off. Now, the reason there's carbon monoxide in your freeze storage bags and in your jars is when you use the little oxygen absorbers, the oxygen absorbers contain iron. But as a secondary ingredient, they also contain some salts and some charcoal. And what happens when the iron absorbs the oxygen, there's a thermal chemical reaction that happens, creates heat. And because there's charcoal or carbon in that little packet along with everything else, some of that carbon also gets burned in that thermal chemical reaction. And because the carbon gets burned, it creates carbon monoxide. Now that's nothing to fear. It's not that much. And if you think about it, it's actually a good thing. If you use oxygen absorbers in grains and things like that that could have weevils, the carbon monoxide is actually a good beneficial gas to have that will kill the weevils. Carbon monoxide does not change the taste or the texture or anything else. It's a gas that to humans is poisonous in large quantities, but there's not enough in here to worry about. So just don't freak out about that. So we're going to have a low oxygen alarm. We're going to have a carbon monoxide alarm, and we're looking for the hydrogen sulfide alarm to go off also. Well, we're hoping it doesn't go off, but if there's spoiled food in here, the hydrogen sulfide alarm will go off, but I don't think it's going to go off. I think we'll be fine. So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to make an incision here. And I'm going to make an incision down here on the bottom. I guess I should turn this on. So the self-test is okay. So we're going to go ahead and insert this now. And there goes the alarms. We're at 151 parts per million on carbon monoxide. And we are picking up, okay, we were at 5% oxygen at first, but the thing that I'm looking for is this H2S ppm, which is hydrogen sulfide gas. So this thing is just a freaking out with the amount of carbon monoxide and oxygen. But the thing that makes me happy is there's no hydrogen sulfide gas. Now if I pull this out, eventually fresh air is going to go in here and we'll clear these alarms. So with that being said, I can go ahead and open this package up. We're going to do the same thing with our crab meat. I'm going to go ahead and put an opening up here at the top, one down here at the bottom, and we're going to insert the probe inside. And there it goes wild. We're at 18 parts per million in carbon monoxide and climbing. We're down to 4%, down to about almost 3% of oxygen. But the most important thing I'm looking at is there's no readings of hydrogen sulfide in this package, which is a good sign. It says that this package doesn't have any spoilage in it. So we're going to go ahead and open this up. And there we have it. Oops. So this is about, sorry about the interruption. This is a I just got a text on my phone that my vacuum pump just started running on my freeze dryer. Sorry about that. Let me turn this off. Okay. So anyway, that's crab meat right there. Smells wonderful. Looks wonderful. Tastes like crab meat. Well, imitation crab meat. So anyway, I'm going to rehydrate some of the crab meat in a bowl and taste that. And with the tuna fish, I'm going to make a sandwich for lunch. So I'll be right back with you. I'm rehydrating my crab meat. I just poured some water on top of it, and this crab meat will take what it needs to rehydrate. But I don't want to do that with my tuna fish because I don't want soggy tuna fish. So I'm just adding a little bit of water at a time because I don't want to overhydrate the tuna fish, and it's about to the texture it should be. Now, some people will put celery salt or celery seed in with the tuna fish. Sometimes I'll cut up a piece of celery and actually put in bits and pieces of celery in there. My wife will often put some pickle relish. But I'm just going to have a good old-fashioned tuna fish sandwich with mayo without anything else. See how that tastes. Just a little bit more mayo. I have not had a tuna fish sandwich for eons. Okay. Get some of my bread out here. When I was a kid, I loved tuna fish sandwiches. Gotta get a glass of milk. Okay, so anyway, get the mic out of my mouth. This tastes like a tuna fish sandwich. It's really good, considering this tuna fish is 3 years old. Had to get some milk. This has been a total success. Freeze drying seafood. The only mistake I probably made with this tuna fish, this is 10 cans of tuna fish. That's a lot. I could feed my neighborhood with this amount. So what I would probably do, I'd probably get your freeze-dried bag, cut them in half, seal the ends, make smaller bags, and only put one or two cans. So I'm going to repackage this tuna fish here into smaller units, throw a new oxygen absorber inside, and put it back into my food storage. But we got to check this out too. This is the imitation crab. Tastes like crab. So this little venture has been very successful. I think we did 5 different types of seafood. We did shrimp, we did tilapia, salmon, imitation crab, and tuna fish. So seafood, really easy to freeze dry. It's something you should probably try. It works out pretty good. I hope you learned something from this. I thoroughly enjoyed making this video, and I hope this was beneficial to you. As always, I'd ask you to subscribe. That just makes me able to make more videos to send out to people to view. So, thank you for your time, and remember, go forth and freeze dry the world.